Hey guys, welcome to your reacting to Demakes, Scott the Waz by Scott the Waz. Now, I have not seen this, and I don't really know what Demakes are. I know what remakes are, obviously. You know, it's when you take a game and then you remake it for a new generation, or, you know, up the graphics a little bit and update it. And some of them are successful, others are not really. They're kind of just the same game, but they, you know, update one thing. Like, I remember one game just updated the water graphics, and that was really it. But, yeah, anyways, guys, we're using some description. Make sure I just got the Waz and some description. Let's just get right into it.
Hey, all, Scott here. Imagine today's events occurring in the past. What would it be like to live in an era prior to this very moment?
5 minutes ago.
What would it mean to say in 5 minutes? What the hell is this? Why is it good? We need to go a hint closer to utter dog shit. I said a hint. The year is 1987.
Ooh.
This is what we call
Tiger Handhelds.
That was a short game of 20 questions.
At the time, things could only go up graphically. They were trying all kinds of 3D styles. Some games you could hear crystal clear sound.
Okay, so here's some context.
And other games were movies you could slightly interact with. The future was looking bright. Imagine what video games will look like 30 years from now. Holy f***. Gets wider.
Oh yeah.
Of course, behind new video game consoles, better graphics. I'll let you shoot me in the foot if you look nice. We all want our video games to look better each and every generation, but sometimes it's fun not to care. The graphical style of older games were simpler, no doubt, but there was a certain magic to it. That old school Atari 2600.
So is this what that video is about?
Great.
Like,
but there's something to be said
video games that have an older style in the present,
making it obvious to them that these are aliens in 4 pixels or less. It's oddly beautiful. Let the record show, I'm also legally blind. But when we move into the 8-bit and 16-bit eras, these are much easier to find worth in. A similar style of making the most out of limitations, but this feels more like actual art somebody drew that was then squished into a cartridge. 16-bit art is so much better too. This was taking pixel art and adding so many more colors and details in the music of this era. Oh my god, it may be a bunch of bleeps and bloops, but it's all organized in such catchy and mesmerizing ways. Again, it's so cool how they would make something so beautiful out of something so limiting. And due to how simple things were, it was easier to immediately understand what make these games tick. Modern games are so full of cutscenes and 3D eye candy that it can sometimes distract you from the core of the game, which might not be that great. Because of this, older games has never really died out, not only because less powerful handheld systems kept 2D pixelated jargon alive while the home consoles tried shoving f***ing polygons down our throat, but because people legitimately like these art styles, this music, these simpler, more get-to-the-chase type games. It doesn't just remind people who peaked in high school of better times, some just like this kind of stuff. The problem is, most think older games look outdated. And 99% of the time, they would be correct. So to get modern gamers to play the classics, you might just have to remake them. Giving them new
visuals. Oh yeah, so he's now gonna go into remakes?
More soundtrack, even more content. But, like I said, many still value this older style of
game. So it's like Demakes, like remaking a game, but making the graphics look less appealing?
What if we took this modern thing and tried to recreate it using this rock? This is a Demake.
Okay.
Or older hardware, possibly generations older, or it's just made in the style of older titles. It's interesting to see how a modern game works when it's met with the limitations of living in 1994. It doesn't. Most demakes are fan-made. Makes sense. If Nintendo isn't gonna put Smash Brothers on a Game Boy, damn it, I'm gonna. One of the most famous examples of this is Halo 2600, a demake of Halo for the Atari 2600. Now, to be fair, this is more complex.
Oh yeah, so these like made by fans, right?
Atari. I can't even begin to port these graphics over. Well, we can do the color green. No, this is turning the concept of Halo's story, characters, and some of the gameplay and trying to make it work as an old school Atari game. It's pretty neat to think about how you recontextualize things that have only ever been seen in first person 3D into a 2D sprite, and not just any 2D sprite, a bad one. However, I think what made this game truly famous in the demake realm was the fact it was made by one Ed Fries. He was actually the vice president of Microsoft's game publishing division up until 2004, so can you really consider this a fan-made demake when it was made by a Microsoft employee who
worked
on the Halo series? Well, this is far from official. Fries released this in 2010, 6 years after he left Microsoft, and even if he was still working at Microsoft when he made this, it was just a hobby project to attempt to make a Halo game for
Yeah, true.
But it's more official than pretty much any other unofficial demakes, so you gotta give it credit. I think the Atari demakes are pretty interesting because I feel like you can make most games conceptually work on an NES or SNES with little issue. I mean, they would look and play wildly different, but I could fully imagine demakes of The Last of Us and Dark Souls on those platforms. These consoles can produce high-quality gameplay and stories. Atari is a different beast. You pretty much have to rethink a game and turn it into a high score kind of game.
Yeah, Atari is just like very minimal pixels.
Super Mario Brothers and The Legend of Zelda. Mario is pretty impressively close. Zelda has more in common with a loading screen, but these are fan creations, the video game false prophet. What about official Demakes? Well, they aren't the most common, but when they happen, they really double dragon on Atari 2600. Gazoonhide. You truly see the power of the Demake with Atari. I mean, this thing runs on pencil.
Oh.
Are you going to make Donkey Kong Jr. work on Atari? You don't. Now, Atari seems to be the worst we can go back in terms of Demaking, but how much simpler can we get? It's dangerous to ask me words. So we have Double Dragon on Atari,
the Tiger
or Double
handheld.
Dragon the LCD handheld game. Pick your poison. I feel that many would disagree with the notion that these are Demakes, but if you consider Halo 2600 to be a Demake, I think these fit the bill. This was the cheap alternative to buying a real man's handheld. The Tiger Electronics LCD games took the full name and branding of arcade and console games and made calculators out of them. These often are nowhere near replacements for the actual things, rather reinterpretations of the classics that can be displayed in a sticky notes worth of screen real estate. And damn it if that isn't a Demake. The Tiger games are pretty gross. They take the bare minimum concept of these games and make this a high score based, overly simplistic romp that's just an endurance test.
And yeah, the Tiger games are not great.
They have their own LCD games with the Game & Watch brand, in which they themselves converted their games over to. These, however, are much more well designed. They're still simplistic, but there's more of an addictive challenge to these compared to what I found in a morgue. And when the game they were remaking for Game & Watch was too complicated for the LCD screens, they would make something entirely new for them, like with Super Mario Brothers and Zelda. The LCD remake is probably as low as we can go, unless you count charades. So, instead of pathetic, let's try for Fucking Bizarre, my new store. Sega hit it big with the Sega Genesis here in North America, with their previous console, the Sega Master System. Look at it. Does it look like it would do well here? Maybe Brazil. The Master System was a long-lasting success in Europe and Brazil. They just loved grid paper and failure. While the console ended in 1992 here in the States, it lived on for years longer in other regions, especially in Brazil, where it has yet to be officially discontinued.
Maybe they just forgot.
But because of its success, Demakes of popular Sega Genesis games were common for the platform. Sonic came over, though more so in specially designed games for the Master System. Streets of Rage, Michael Jackson's Moonwalker, because good versions of those games weren't good enough. But the Demake I want to focus on here is Street Fighter 2. Yeah, Street Fighter 2 on the Sega Master System, because damn, does that sound good right about now?
Round one. Fight.
That hits the spot. Honestly, for a version of Street Fighter 2 on an 8-bit console,
that looks
good. I mean, character moves are missing, so it's not like a full-fledged
I mean,
it's not like this is the full Street Fighter
2. It looks alright.
By my cart, but it's still a full experience. Nah, this simply does the job for Master System owners when it's Street Fighter 2 and not much else. Graphically, I think this looks pretty damn good. Audioly, I too enjoy making soundtracks with elevators. For what it's worth, Street Fighter 2 on Master System is fascinating. It only released in Brazil in 1997, and Capcom greenlit it because they were duped into thinking this was a Sega Genesis version of the game. The developer then revealed they were playing on the Master System, and they said, "Wow, this fucking stunk for the Genesis, but for the Master System, this could be worse." It was approved. Well, I'd rather play this than the Game Boy version, which that's only a remake. The portable variant of a game was almost always lesser in every way. But just like Street Fighter on Master System, it could be worse. I think many Game Boy demakes are fairly impressive. I mean, DuckTales on this thing is damn close to DuckTales How God Intended. Developers had to choose whether to make a version of the game designed with the Game Boy in mind, or just try to cram funny shit in the car. It's a balancing act. Would it really be easier to make a Lion King game for the NES, or just take the SNES game and downgrade the hell out of it? This looks unnatural.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
If I played this as a kid, I would still think to myself, this feels like a downgraded version of something that already exists. I mean, designing a game from scratch for a system is a lot of work, but it's also really hard to get the Lion King on SNES to run on the NES. You know the old saying. The NES got a few demakes. I'd consider Mighty Final Fight to be one of these. This is a Final Fight game made specifically for the NES. It's a retelling of the first game's story, so
okay.
I would consider this a demake. Take that, Senate. However, everything else is really this game's own thing. If you consider Final Fantasy VII Remake to be a remake, give Mighty Final Fight a chance. This is definitely more of a spoof on the original. They made all the characters children and built it entirely for the NES. It was definitely meant to give NES owners a Final Fight experience while also making sure.
So this is just using examples, or giving examples.
I'm a proud NES owner. Mighty Final Fight is its own thing, and isn't bogged down by the limitations of the console it's on. Rather, Capcom used the limitations to their advantage while creating this thing. This is how you do a demake, and it might not even qualify as one. That's why we go back to the Game Boy line with Game Boy Color and
Rayman on the Game Boy Color.
Finally, I can play Grand Theft Auto portably. I never said I was happy with my life. For some reason, developers constantly tried to take these big console experiences and shove them on the GBC. Resident Evil was being worked on. Well, it was canceled. Looking at what was accomplished, it's impressive and concerning. Think about how advanced society would be if we didn't spend...
That was on the Game Boy Color.
The Game Boy. I mean, this looks like it's straight up Resident Evil, but what ended up releasing was Resident Evil Gaiden, something more original for the system.
Oh, okay.
Still trying to make it as full-fledged of an RE game as it could be, including this rhythm game combat mechanic to incorporate first-person shooting, which is honestly pretty clever.
That's
and of course,
an interesting
GTA
idea.
2. I'm sure not many people knew this was a thing, on top of the fact the first game is on here as well. In fact, that worked on the original Game Boy. These are like the coolest items at an antique mall. Absolutely
GTA's on the Game
but you
Boy.
Couldn't pay me to lick them. These are really not great versions, but just the fact they even resemble a Grand Theft Auto game, I think is enough. Were you really expecting to pop GTA 2 into your Game Boy Color and be enthralled? No, this game was created with the intent of people saying, Grand Theft Auto on Game Boy Color, and nothing more. But thankfully, Grand Theft Auto on Game Boy Advance is another story. And most of the joy from this game comes from the fact I'm gutting people on 2 AA's. But this is a legitimate Grand Theft Auto with not a ton of concessions made. This wouldn't be considered a demake, however, considering it's a completely original entry in the franchise. Now, Pac-Man World, that just got diagnosed. The Game Boy Advance multi-platform games that were completely different from handheld to console. I was definitely expecting this to be a 2D platformer based on the PS1 game. Was I ever gleefully disappointed? Hey, they took the PS1 game and transformed it into a 2D sprite paradise. Is it better this way? Well, it depends on if you like dog sh**. See, this is the biggest issue with DMX. It feels like you're punching down. Well, the Game Boy Advance version of Super Sponge isn't as good as the PlayStation 1. Well, duh. Of course, what makes this game special is seeing how they convert elements that could only be done on the more powerful system. Sometimes they whittle them down to their core. Konami couldn't really port the first Silent Hill to Game Boy Advance, or they could, they just knew it wouldn't be pretty. So they converted it into a visual novel, released only in Japan. See, while I would have loved to try Silent Hill on Game Boy Advance, we know it would have stunk. Sometimes developers
They
make the game for lesser hardware or create something more suited for it. Because even if they work on lesser hardware, I think I, alongside many others, care more about seeing it just exist, not necessarily if it's just as good or better than the source material.
True. That's very true, yeah.
Starpoint was a game. Thanks for asking. One of the most forgettable and generic games from the Xbox 360 PS3 era. It was done by Capcom, but it was just so lifeless and lame. Just look at this cover. Look at this name. Without the title, would anybody have gone, oh yeah, that's a Dark Void. It's just an underwhelming third-person shooter that completely got overshadowed by its spin-off on Nintendo DSiWare. Everybody has that more successful cousin. Dark Void Zero isn't necessarily a demake, but it has the spirit of one. The concept here is, what if Dark Void wasn't an original game? Turns out it was a reboot or sequel to a lost Capcom NES game. You gotta hand it to them, they truly ran with this idea, even...
That's an interesting idea.
...electronic manual. Totally giving an excuse as to why it's on a dual-screen handheld, because it was on the PlayChoice 10 dual-screen arcade machine. They even got Jimmy Fallon in on the idea that this was, in fact, originally an NES game. When they break out the talk show host, everybody goes, oh, shit. On that day, all Late Night with Jimmy Fallon viewers bought Dark Void Zero. The game itself actually gives off a lot of 80s Capcom vibes. Comparing it to the real-life Dark Void, it kind of feels like how Bionic Commando on NES compares to Bionic Commando on Xbox 360. What an insult. The NES style is prime for demake territory. It's more impressive to demake for Atari, but demaking a modern game for NES, well, it just might be playable. Namco demade Pac-Man Championship Edition, turning it into something worthy of being on an NES cartridge. It was included in Namco Museum Archives Volume 1, and it might just be better than the original. To be fair, the original Pac-Man Championship Edition is good, but its aesthetic reminds me so much of the Superior Championship Editions DX and 2 that it's really hard for me to go back to it. Championship Edition on NES oddly feels fresher even though it looks ass old.
You're
it's
right.
So addictive.
He's actually right though, because it has an aesthetic.
It feel faster. It legitimately feels like its own experience, and honestly, if I had to choose between the two versions, I'm going NES. Retro City Rampage originally started development as an NES demake of Grand Theft Auto. It's a good thing they changed course. While it's obviously inspired by GTA and NES games, the final release is more than that. It's not GTA, and it couldn't run on an NES. While you could still look at it as a spiritual demake, the developer made sure you didn't have to look far for the actual one. Included in the Wii release is ROM City Rampage, a version of the game that runs on NES. Plus, they made a version for MS-DOS on a floppy disk. These people scare me. These are the fun demakes. They bring games to garbage hardware because... Now, downgraded ports, you could totally consider demakes. Doom on Nintendo Switch? Well, they technically did demake it. But that's not really too fun to discuss. Like, here's Rayman Origins on Xbox 360. Now on Wii. Now on 3DS. How did they do it?
Different graphical stuff that doesn't really matter.
Well, fans do it all the time. Final Fantasy VII on NES, Super Smash Land on Game Boy, but even Nintendo does it. Their prototype for Breath of the Wild...
Oh yeah, Wii U,
They made Breath of the Wild for NES, and then made Breath of the Wild. Well, this is just a remake. I mean, they are super guilty of Demakes.
What?
General. Remember the great Nintendo 3DS Wii U ports of 2016 and 17? Yes, Hyrule Warriors Legends. It runs. This is disgusting. I have no idea how anybody played this game legitimately on 3DS. Of course, it runs better on new 3DS models, but so would molasses. Doesn't make it fast. I don't care. To me, this game just doesn't belong here. This gives off Lion King NES vibes. Just a sense of this not belonging. Everything feels off. Super Mario Maker for Nintendo 3DS, I think, feels more justified, and it's still pointless. That's an insult to Mario Maker and an even bigger one to Hyrule Warriors. You can never upload stages with this version. You can only play stages that were uploaded from the Wii U version. At the very least, if they let you transfer stages you made to the Wii U to then upload, it would still be stupid, but at least there would be a way. There's no point to any of this, though it's still very charming to see this game run on 3DS. I just love how they had to downgrade New Super Mario Bros. U from the Wii U to this platform when New Super Mario Bros. 2 was on it and looked fine. They could have used these assets. No, it doesn't look not fine enough. The New Super Mario Bros. U art style on 3DS is amazingly pixelated, and it's funny because this is the art style they chose to represent on the box. Luigi and Yoshi's Woolly World is a great conversion. It looks and plays great, and I find it very charming how they converted the 3D world map into a 2D one. While the 3D map is cooler on the Wii U version, the 2D one on 3DS just flat out makes more sense. This is a 2D platformer after all. Regardless of if these are good versions of the games, Demakes are amazing. They may not be more fun to play, they may just be f***ing putrid, but they're just so interesting to analyze, every last one of them. To see how a game as massive as Breath of the Wild would work on NES, or just seeing Hyrule Warriors do something it shouldn't, I love seeing games represented in a different way than the norm, and these demakes help you to appreciate the game design. Without all those fancy 3D graphics, most of these games still hold up at their core. In some cases, they can be better not bogged down with cutscenes and loading screens. And it gave us a chance to play Rayman Arena on the PlayStation 1. Yeah, this is weird. So Rayman Rush is a demake of Rayman Arena for PS1. It removes modes and just focuses on this racing game mode. That's it. But even though it released after Arena came out in Europe, it released before Arena did here in North America. So if you live in Ohio, is this a demake or is Rayman Arena a remake? What about Final Fantasy 15 Pocket Edition? This is a demake of Final Fantasy
for
mobile phones. It uses a cutesy new art style and is played from a top-down perspective, but follows a shortened take on the same story. But man, they just oversimplified so much here. As a mobile game, it really likes it when you win, and the game just feels kind of mindless to me. At this point, you're better off just watching Final Fantasy 15 cutscenes on your phone. But then the demake got a remake with Final Fantasy 15 Pocket Edition HD. You can finally play this on Xbox One. Or play Final Fantasy 15, your choice. To both of these games. A lot of people didn't like Final Fantasy 15, so you've got Pocket Edition, but a lot of people don't like Pocket Edition, so it's truly a matter of preference. Except on Nintendo Switch, where this is the only Final Fantasy 15 you've got.
Because who needs
really
when you have dog shit?
So yeah, honestly, this was a really good review. I like how he explains everything. The fact that he gives, you know, context to the demakes by explaining what remakes are, and then explaining that it's basically just the opposite, which actually makes sense with the games, you know, the name as well. Yeah, honestly, this was a very good video, and the examples he gives, I think, are very good. I think they're very good. And, you know, it also adds to the comedy, too. I feel like the comedy is really good in this video. Probably not the best I've seen from him, but still, it's pretty good. So yeah, honestly, I enjoyed it. So yeah, if you guys did enjoy, leave a like and subscribe to my channel. See you next one. Bye!